Hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here, and today we're going to be learning about the letter E.
Ah! Oh, sweet! We just caught a talking frog! The junior master naturalists are going to love this. Here, let's pass this off to Miss Jessie. Oh, hey! Sorry, I didn't see you there. So, my name's Tim, and I work for the Perot Museum of Nature and Science, and today we're out studying ephemeral ponds. Oh, they're also called vernal pools, and ephemeral ponds are pretty unique wetlands because they're there very temporarily. They often are just maybe a few weeks, a few months. Sometimes they'll be there a couple years and then they dry up. It's pretty important to have this type of wetland because they won't have things in them like fish. So what do fish like to eat? That's right, they like to eat anything that will fit in their mouth. So anything in the water that's small enough to eat is fair game to a fish. Now, ephemeral ponds, because they dry up, won't have fish in them normally, unless somebody's placed them there. Now, if you can think about some other animals that might make use of this pond, what kinds of animals can you think of? That's right, amphibians and aquatic insects. So, amphibians like ephemeral ponds because they can lay their eggs and it keeps their tadpoles safe when they hatch. And aquatic insects like it because, again, there's no fish, and there's room for them to spread out. Their larvae and their nymphs can grow. That's pretty important because not all wetlands have that protection that the ephemeral ponds offer. So we're going to take a couple looks at different types of ephemeral ponds and maybe make a device that's going to help us look down into those ponds and see what kinds of creatures are living there. Come with me.
Okay, here's our first wetland area, our first ephemeral pond. This one happens to be in the middle of a parking lot. And this one is pretty interesting. In the spring, it gets anything from tadpoles to aquatic isopods, which are basically aquatic roly-polies, if you're familiar with those. It gets dragonflies, it gets water boatmen, whirligig beetles, predaceous diving beetles, water bugs. Some pretty cool stuff. So in the middle of the summer though, this pond either completely dries up or almost dries up to where it's not really healthy for animals to live anymore because the oxygen levels get very low. So a trade-off for having the safety of a pool that is free from fish is that it will dry up, and you'll find that tadpoles' life cycles often speed up as the ponds get warmer when they get shallow and the sun's drying them out, because they're trying to hurry up and get ready to turn into the froglets. So you'll have things in here, dragonflies use these emergent plants to crawl out on the stalks so they can turn into the adults when they shed their skin. You find that all the animals that live in here have adapted so that they have some sort of way of surviving that drying up nature of this pool. So there is a trade-off for the safety of the habitat. Some animals have adapted lifestyles that speed up. Some of them actually form cysts around their eggs so that they can stay dried up sometimes for years. And then when the pools finally fill with water again, they will hatch out from those encysted eggs and start the cycle all over again. If you're lucky in this area, sometimes you see something called fairy shrimp. And they're pretty cool. We have giant fairy shrimp that are about an inch long, and they can stay for years sometimes stuck inside that encysted egg just waiting for the waters to let them hatch. So I'm gonna go out and scoop a little bit of pond life out of this pond and take it over, and then we're gonna use our viewers to try to see what we can see both in the pond and in the sample that we put in our bucket. So hold on just a minute.
Depending on the species of frog, they may actually have already laid eggs earlier in the year that have hatched out already and turned into adults.
All right.
like we've got some pretty cool stuff here. Put it in our bucket. And take it with us.
So this is our second ephemeral wetland. It happens to take place in a forest. You still find a lot of the same insects there, as well as tadpoles sometimes, but you also, in this area, you find a lot more of the fishing spiders, like the Dolomites fishing spiders that live on tree trunks and dive down into the water to grab other animals, as well as crayfish. I see a lot more snakes back here, not that they're invertebrates, but they're here hunting the animals like tadpoles and frogs. They'll eat some of the insects as well, but they're really here after the frogs, either trying to breed early in the year or their offspring that are emerging out of the pools.
This is our third and final ephemeral pond. When we make our viewers, which we're going to do in just a minute, you can use any body of water as long as you're careful and have your parents' permission. You could sit on a rock in a stream and see down through the ripples. Your viewer is going to help block the ripples. You can look in a pond like this, and it should help block the glare, and painting the inside black should also help block the glare. Maybe you have a pond near your house or at your local park. You could test it different places and see if you see different types of animals. Just don't forget, if you take some animals with you to look at home in a bucket or aquarium, don't forget to return them where you found them when you're done exploring.
All right, now we're going to build our underwater viewer. The first thing you'll need is some sort of plastic container. Any container with a little snap top lid would work. If you don't have something with a lid, like this bucket, you could still use the bottom of it. You just won't be able to snap your plastic in, so you'll have to have rubber bands. So you either need a lid or rubber bands. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our plastic container. We're going to carefully cut the circle out of the top of the lid. And carefully cut the bottom out of our container as well. Now you want to be careful, not cut your finger like I did. You want to have an adult help you with this. I think the smaller scissors work a little better. And this is the part that we're going to look through when we look down into the pond water. So, after you have the bottom cut out of your container and the center cut out of your lid, you need a piece of plastic. So you can use plastic wrap, or I chose this Ziploc bag because it's a little bit thicker plastic. The good news is if you end up ripping your plastic, you can just replace the plastic because you can unsnap your lid or redo your rubber bands. So we're going to cut this piece of plastic so we can use the flat sheet. Now, it's your choice. If you want to make it a little bit easier to see into the water, sometimes people will paint the inside of their containers with black paint that's water resistant. You could use this as long as you're not getting it wet. I used some spray paint a little bit ago and sprayed the inside of this. If you do either of those, you should let an adult help you with that. So we're going to take our plastic sheet, set it on top of our opening, place our lid over top of that, and press it down. So we are trapping our piece of plastic over the end of the viewer, like that, so we can look through it in the water.
Another thing I saw somebody do was to take a waterproof LED flashlight and place it inside their container in the wall and tape it to the wall. We could do that with duct tape. We've got some patriotic duct tape here. I'm not gonna do that for now because it's pretty light out today, so I'm hoping that we'll be okay with just what we have. If you were to use a bucket, you could cut the bottom out of it and maybe use a piece of plexiglass and silicone to seal it on there with, or maybe two-part epoxy, anything that keeps the water from seeping into your container. So let's go try out our containers.
All right, I found two willing test subjects to check out our underwater viewers we just created.
I found some eggs too.
What are you guys seeing?
We're seeing eggs.
Eggs?
Snails?
Cool.
I see a shell.
Cool. Probably a snail shell?
Uh-huh.
All right. So what do you guys think of the underwater viewers? Are they pretty cool?
Yeah.
Thumbs up? Yeah? All right. Okay. Well, I hope you guys have enjoyed this session. Hopefully in April we're going to try to do another one on water quality using aquatic invertebrates, testing out how ponds or how healthy they are depending on how many different kinds of aquatic invertebrates and what kinds are in there. So hope you guys enjoyed this, and talk to you later. Bye.